Nicolas, I'm not outspoken enough to express all the thanks to the organizers, and actually my colleagues did it perfectly. And also I have a problem with discussing asymmetric relations, because again, we told a lot yesterday about this. But still, I have to specify something. First of all, asymmetric relations is a very broad notion, and of course it covers very different relations from colonial, metropole versus colony, or some patronizing state versus client state, but also quite normal relations like, you know, Australia, New Zealand, or exemplary America and Canada. Even though also they are quite problematic, probably you remember a very famous statement made by Canadian Prime Minister Paul Trudeau back in 1968 in Washington, when he compared sharing the landmass with such a huge neighbor as the United States as sleeping in bed with elephant. And however mild and polite and nice elephant is, still it's a problem, you know, because you feel every movement, every sigh, every breeze of this beast. And of course, we share landmass with a much more reckless elephant. This is both Ukrainian and Polish problem. So in this regard, at least in this regard, we are not asymmetrical. But also in many other terms, Ukraine and Poland are quite comparable countries because they have more or less the same population and similar territory. And actually, GDP was very similar until Poland began radical reforms in the early 90s and Ukraine failed. But still, it can be caught up and still they could be comparable in this regard. But what is important, of course, Ukraine society has always been a society with incomplete structure, and this is fundamental difference from Polish, because Polish society, even in periods of stateless period, still had some sort of aristocracy, of intelligentsia. And of course, they produced high culture, which was very, very big problem in Ukraine. So relations between these countries, of course, they resemble in many regards colonial metropole versus colony. In Lévi-Strauss terms, it was like raw and boiled, yeah, or crude and prepared. In a way, Ukrainians have similar relations with Poles and Russians, because in both cases we have this colonial paradigm. We have relations between Robinson Crusoe and Friday, but there are some nuances, because Russian Robinson actually he perceives Ukrainians as not actually as beloved Friday. So it's not Friday, it's not quite a savage. It's a savage, but it's savage with some family relations. It's like a cousin, a village bumpkin, who is basically nice but stupid and needs some care and some occasional punches he should be guided. And this is actually what they are doing. From Polish attitude is more ambiguous, because this Friday is not necessarily nice. Actually, since Khmelnytsky time, it was rather ugly. Yes, but some of them could be nice. So attitude is more ambivalent. But still, it's very, very, very paternalistic. And even today, you know, if you listen to conversations in Warsaw, in Polish saloons, you would hear how quite intelligent people discuss their own Ukrainian lady, because many of them have Ukrainian cleaners or some other ladies who do home job, and they discuss like, you know, my Ukrainian Friday is nice and very diligent, and my is not so nice. I have to find another. The Ukraine Friday, moja Ukrainka, tak? Ja mam swoją Ukrainkę. It's very fashionable to have my own Ukrainian. It's okay. I have nothing against that, because we have provide some labor force, and these people support their families in Ukraine. So it's basically okay. It's a very good example of this asymmetric relations and kind of cohabitance. But still, relations are asymmetrical and in foreseeable futures that will remain like this, because it's not only a matter of economic. I agree. Somebody yesterday mentioned that it's important to have Ukraine reformed and to be on par with developed nations of Europe. It's okay. I fully agree. But still. As you know, actually, from Polish-German stereotypes, still it takes some more time to overcome this negative attitudes. And what is more optimistic in this story is that Poles, this fundamental difference from Russians, they do not perceive, they do not treat Ukrainians as relatives, as almost the same people. They don't place us on the same bag, and I'm happy with this. You know, I prefer to be hated by Poles than to be loved by Russians. It's a paradox. But it's quite reasonable, because I can have dialogue, because even if I'm disliked in Poland, I'm still as perceived as equal, more or less equal, as a person who can be nice or not, but is a subject, not object. In Russia, I'm still object. I'm still, you know, still somebody who is on the lower level, who should be guided, who should be patronized, and is not a subject who can make his own decision. So it's Friday who cannot himself dream about freedom, about dignity, and so of course this is crazy Friday. This Friday is probably hijacked by some American Robinson or some Jewish Robinson or Polish Robinson, but he's. You know, Ukraine Friday cannot make Maidan himself. It's absolutely impossible from Russian point of view. It's a fundamental difference. So what is the result of this optimistic? What is the result of this difference? I follow different opinion surveys, and in Poland generally these opinion surveys reveal some rather at best. Ambivalent attitude for the Ukrainians, I would say rather negative. So typically, we can refer here to the most regular CBOS opinion surveys, and they usually use this scale from +3 to -3. They ask respondents to place different nationalities on this scale, from +3 to -3. And usually Ukrainians are, not usually, all the time, they are in the lowest part of the scale, between -1, -2. Of course, in time they went up a little bit, but they still did not reach positive part of the scale. In Ukraine, you have the opposite, actually, situation, because Poles and Poland are seen very positively. But again, it's difficult to compare, because in Ukraine, sociological research applies Bogardo scale, which basically this method says not much about attitude, but rather about commonality, about how much we are accustomed to see these people or that people. Because, you know, Bogardo's scale refers to, it consists of 7 or 6 questions. Would you like to have this nationality, a relative, a neighbor, or employee, or a tourist, or not to allow them to visit the country at all? Of course, gypsies are at the bottom, and they are racially different people are up and on. So in Ukraine, of course, this method reveals that Russians and Belarusians are the closest, because they are like us, they are very similar. Jews are also, Jews come third, because they are also Soviet, or used to be Soviet. Probably the answer would be different if it specifies that whether we mean Soviet or post-Soviet Jews, or Jews from Israel or America. I suspect that the response would be different, because we have different questions about Ukrainians from Ukraine and Ukrainians from diaspora. And Ukrainians from diaspora are seen as they are placed lower. Only recently they bypassed Poles and other foreigners. So still they are perceived with some suspicion. They are not ours. So we cannot compare this different methods. But still Ukraine attitude is basically much more positive. It's not as ambivalent as Polish. But what is interesting, despite all this negative rather negative attitudes toward Ukrainians, negative perception of Ukraine and Ukrainians, the other questions, other type of questions, is very surprising, because if the polls are asked, would you like to support Ukraine economically? Would you like to support Ukraine politically, diplomatically? Would you? All, you know, all these questions give very clear majority yes. So how to explain this strange situation? You know, people and are perceived rather negatively, but still they should be supported, they should be promoted, and so on. My only explanation, only possible explanation, I believe, is like following. When you ask about attitudes, people very often, not all the time, but very often they refer to the past. They refer to some, you know, something they read, they had about relatives and so on. They recollect Volyn massacre or something like this, and Bandera story and so on. But basically they are past oriented. They their information comes from the past. And of course, they very often they say no. But when they ask about support, about something real, they think about the future. And they think strategically. And their response is comes from their mind, not from their heart, not from emotions, but from reason. And this is the only explanation I can provide. And of course, this is this very positive side. I believe it good, gives us good chances for the future. And finally, about benefits. Actually, we are already benefiting from this asymmetric relations, which means that not only it's not only a matter of economic cooperation and so on, because or geopolitical interests, they could be, they are not related from symmetric or asymmetric relations. They are quite normal for neighbors, whatever they are. But also, I feel that Ukrainians. Well, as I mentioned, they benefit, of course, from this migration. It's a very good opportunity to work in Poland, but also to study. Many people are going there, and they study in Polish institutions. They got some, obtain some experience, and it's also beneficial from Poland, for Poland, because they have these young people. They had workers. And by the way, Polish society perceives this very positively, as far as I know, as I observe. Because, of course, people, most of them work decently, they are diligent, and they are fully integrated in Polish society. So the alternative, there is no alternative for this. And, you know, Czech President Zeman, who is no friend of Ukraine, said recently this, yes, we celebrate Ukrainians in Czech Republic because they are really good. And he explains this in politically incorrect way, because he suggested his country fellows that otherwise we would have people from other regions which are not so well integrated, could be not so well integrated into Czech society. Probably the same issue in Poland. Of course, it's good to feel culturally proximate group. But also, I feel that for Poles it's very good, because they have to raise their status within the EU. They are major experts on Eastern issues. They are major promoters of Western agenda in the East. They are main experts. They have, because of Ukraine, they have really good status, good stance, good profile within the European Union. Of course, they can do more to analyze this, you know, colonial, post-colonial complexes. It also could be good psychological therapy for Polish society if they pay more attention to these specific relations. Ukrainians also can do more to benefit from these relations, in particular to examine the past and to draw more from common heritage. I feel that, you know, Polish heritage, Polish legacy is largely underestimated of Ukraine, for obvious reasons, of course, because Ukrainians fought against Poles, and Ukrainians all the time, they deny this, you know, it was kind of a colonial, anti-colonial struggle. But now we reach the point when we could cross the line and reach some sort of post-coloniality, not only in terms of post-after. Like, in this regard, post does not mean only after, something that happened after, but also new quality. We should not be afraid of Polish expansion. Poles raise no claims to Ukrainian territory, whatever. So now we can recognize this legacy as very important, political legacy, cultural legacy. Because I noticed that in Ukraine, very few people recognize this. Even in Kyiv, nobody knows that the city of Kyiv spoke Polish language as primary language until the early 19th century. Nobody knows. They would rather believe that Russian was spoken there than Polish. And it's really strange. Also, we cannot practice this post-colonial approach in our relations with Russia. It's another problem because they still have claims to Ukraine. They still fail to recognize Ukrainian sovereignty, etc. So we are not mature enough to reach this post-colonial relations with Russia. They still have features of colonial, anti-colonial. With Poland, it's a different story. We are up to complete these things. So I feel we have very good chances, and it's up to our intellectuals to do this, to develop all these opportunities, to use this potential which actually exists there. Okay, I run out of time. Thank you.